ونسلم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد رسوله النبي الأمين المكين الحنين الكريم الرؤوف الرحيم. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لا أقسم بهذا البلد، وأنت حل بهذا البلد، ووالد وما ولد. صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected brothers, sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah ta'ala, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the utmost blessings of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him, we are here today together on Yawm al-Jum'ah, on the day of Friday. The day of Friday is a day which is an aid for the believers, which is a day of happiness for the believers. And it gives us a chance to come together in Allah's house so that we may reflect the unity and the brotherhood which is found among the Muslim nation. As you know and as you remember, we were talking last week about, and we started a series of lectures about the seerah, the biography of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we discussed, and I said, if you can remember, that the reason why I want to talk about the seerah, the character of Sayyidina Rasulullah, the personality of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is because the month of Rabiul Awwal is coming, in which he was born. But my lectures will be different than the lectures normally we are used to hear. Normally when people talk about the personality, the life of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they will focus and concentrate on the lives, on the years after he announced his prophethood. So he announced his prophethood at the age of 40. So when people will talk about his seerah, mostly you will hear the events which took place after he announced his prophethood. That he was tortured, the Muslims were tortured by the Quraysh or the pagans, and they had to go and migrate to Medina. Then they came back to Mecca and they were a big force. But when they conquered Mecca, never took any revenge from the people. You hear about these events which took place. And the events before he announced his prophethood, the first 40 years of his life, the first 4 decades of his life, normally we Muslims are ignorant about what happened in those 40 years. These are very important 4 decades of his life, very important part of his life. Why? Because the first time when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam announced his prophethood, and he said to people, I am the messenger of God and I want you to believe in one God. I invite you to believe in one God. They all asked him for a proof, for a mu'jiza, a miracle. What is the first proof he provided for the oneness of Allah, of God? Is that Allah said, فَقَدْ لَبِسْتُ فِيكُمْ أُمْرًا مِّن قَبْلِهِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. I have spent a lifetime among you. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Even, and then you do not understand, which means the Prophet was using his 40 years of his life which he spent among the pagans as a proof of him being a prophet. Now when he uses these 40 years for his dalil, for his proof that he was a prophet, it means there was something special in these 40 years. Otherwise he would not have used it as a proof. There must be something special in these 40 years. Something miraculously happened in these 40 years. There was something, and that is why he used this as a proof. If he spent those 40 years as everybody else, and there was nothing special about his first 40 years of his life, then he would never use it as a proof of the oneness of Allah. So that is why I want to talk about especially his first 40 years. But even before his first 40 years, you can say the creation of Muhammad, the Prophet Muhammad, didn't start on 12th Rabiul Awwal when he was born. No. His creation started even before he was born. He was created even before any prophet was created of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I discussed this last week and I gave various references from the Quran and Hadith. I do not want to talk about that now. If there are brothers who are interested in this, on YouTube, you can find the lecture of last Jummah. The title is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, before birth. But and then my name, you can inshallah find it. Today, we finish our talk with the introduction of Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The grandfather of Sayyidina Rasulullah was Abdul Muttalib, who was the son, who was from the Quraysh tribe, and who was from, in the Quraysh, from the Hashimi family. He was the son of Hashim, who was a leader of the tribe of the Quraysh. Abdul Muttalib was a leader of the tribe of the Quraysh. Abdul Muttalib, he had many sons. Among his sons, his youngest son was Abdullah. What was the name of his youngest son? Abdullah, servant of Allah. And Abdul Muttalib, he, after his father passed away, became the leader of the tribe of Quraysh. He was a very respected person in the society. His character, personality was without any faults. He didn't have any negative characteristic. He didn't lie. He wouldn't talk about anyone negatively. He was always smiling. He wanted always to help people. He was always ready to help people. And people could see that there was something shining on his forehead. There was a special light shining from his forehead, which made him more beautiful than any other young man of the Arabs. And that is why everyone wanted to marry this person, Abdul Muttalib, all the ladies. And every leader of the tribe, different tribes, they wanted their daughter to be the wife of this young man. And he was married, Abdul Muttalib, with a lady called Fatima. A lady called Fatima. So Fatima is the grandmother of our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Paternal side. Fatima was a very pious lady. When they were married, they had many children. Among them, and Abdul Muttalib, I said last week as well, just a reminder, he married four wives at different occasions. From one, he had Lubna, he had Abu Lahab. And from a wife named Fatima, who was a very pious lady, he had some children. Among them were Abdullah and Abu Talib. So Abu Talib and Abdullah, they share the same, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Abdullah, the father of Sayyidina Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they share the same mother. So Abdul Muttalib received a dream. He received a dream in which he, the well of Zamzam, as you know, the well of Zamzam, in his dream he was given a message that he has to try to find the well of Zamzam. Because the well of Zamzam, during the time of the pagans, was disappeared. People didn't know where it was. It was disappeared. So Abdul Muttalib received a dream. When he had his dream, he collected all his youngsters, all the men of the tribe of Quraysh, and he told them, I have received a dream. In my dream, I have to find and I have to try to dig the well of Zamzam. And I have been told that it is around the Kaaba, close to the Kaaba. The people, the Quraysh at that time, they said, we rather than just digging, why don't we go to Syria? And there is a great scholar from the Jews and who has knowledge of these things. We will ask him, where exactly do we need to dig? And then it will be easier for us. Because around the Kaaba, around the Qibla, there is a big space, big open space. Where should we try and where should we start our digging? It will be months and months before we have any result. So why don't we go there? While they were going, and Abdul Muttalib, he agreed, because he, even though he in his dream saw that that is the specific place, he said, because these Quraysh didn't want to start digging, he said, at least they have agreed that we will dig. So let us go to that person. While they were going, the camels of the Quraysh, they stopped walking. They stopped. And as soon as they turned the faces of the camels of their animals towards Kaaba, Makkah, they would start walking again. So this was for them a sign
ان انا كنت مطلع